AI is declining in cost faster than any technology ever measured. The cost to operate AI models is halving every 4 months. That's about 4 to 6 times faster than Moore's law. I've been covering AI for over a decade and I'm blown away by what's happening. But I'm also cautiously optimistic about all the hype in the air. Today we're going to look at where top experts think AI is heading. This is a riveting presentation. Honestly, I haven't been this excited since I found out the McRib was coming back. So let's go ahead and get started. This piece by Sequoia is absolutely fascinating, and it's about where AI is heading. And what they're finding is that the generative AI market is stabilizing with a key set of scaled players and alliances. They give some examples here: Microsoft, OpenAI, AWS, Anthropic, Meta, and of course Google and DeepMind. They say only scaled players with economic engines and access to vast sums of capital remain in play. That's rather interesting. They say here, the focus is shifting to the development and scaling of the reasoning layer. That theme is going to persist throughout this presentation. It aims to endow AI systems with deliberate reasoning. So basically what this means is AI is going to start taking some time to think about your questions, not all of them, but this stop and think is called reasoning. So I like this quote here from somebody over at Sequoia, Noam Brown. He says, thinking for longer about what the capital of Bhutan is doesn't help. So of course it's going to be select problems where reasoning makes sense for AI. Now I just wanted to show you this quick clip on Jensen from NVIDIA talking about where he thinks AI is heading.
Inference scaling has gone through the roof.
Right.
The idea that a model, before it answers your answer, had already done internal inference.
Incredible.
10,000 times,
mm-hmm.
is probably not unreasonable.
Mm-hmm.
And it's probably done tree search, it's probably done reinforcement learning on that, it's probably done some simulations, surely done a lot of reflection. It probably looked up some data, looked some information, isn't that right?
Mm-hmm.
And so its context is probably fairly large. I mean, this type of intelligence is, well, that's what we do.
Right.
That's what we do, isn't that right?
What he described there seems to be the first manifestations of general artificial intelligence, or AGI. This is the idea that we're going to, and it's debatable what that timeline looks like, we're going to have AI that's smarter than humans. So the future, Sequoia poses some questions here. What happens when the model can think for hours or days or decades even? What big problems is it going to solve? So this shift is going to be moving from a world of massive pre-trained clusters towards inference clouds. And I love this, where they can scale compute dramatically or dynamically and dramatically based on the complexity of the task. That makes sense, right? So what they say this means is that the addressable market for generative AI is not the software market, but the services market measured in trillions of dollars. And this is a great diagram here. You can see on the left in 2010, the software market and the cloud software market. And then in 2024, you see how cloud as a proportion of software grew dramatically. Of course, right? That's what we've observed. And then there you see $10 trillion worth of software and services, and the AI software market being about $3 billion of that. So where does that lead? Well, they give an example here that's rather interesting. They use this term service as a software, right? So this is the new SaaS. And this firm here, they say, what does it mean to sell work? Well, Sierra is a good example, and this company builds presumably generative AI agents that B2C companies put on their websites to talk with customers. The job for this agent to do is to resolve a customer issue. So Sierra gets paid per resolution. This is similar to that firm I've talked about before that was doing the call center routing. Sierra gets paid per resolution. There's no such thing as a seat per seat subscription. You have a job to do. Sierra does it, and they get paid accordingly. And Sequoia says this is true north for many AI companies. And just talking about call center agents, you'll want to check out this piece we did here on how AI is upending call centers. That's an article. We follow that with a video on this topic. It's rather fascinating. And this Sierra firm is very relevant to the things that we were discussing. So very quickly, a message to our paying subscribers. We absolutely love you and your financial support. If you want any of the collateral in this presentation, drop us an email. If you have a question specifically about anything I talk about today, drop us an email, address it to me, and I'll respond. One value we're always going to keep here at Nanalyze is accessibility. Competent customer support is one of our biggest competitive advantages. So agentic applications, another new term here, Cloud companies sold software per seat. AI companies sell work, dollars per outcome. And we're seeing a new cohort of these agentic applications emerge across various sectors of the knowledge economy. You have Harvey, and there's some examples here, right? So lawyers, work assistants, software engineers, medical scribes, pen tester, that's penetration testing for firms that want to see just how durable their solutions are. And of course, those can be used maliciously as well. And of course, Sierra that we already discussed. Now, what does this mean for SaaS? I really liked this part of that report from Sequoia, or article, if you will. They said earlier this year, they met with their LPs, that's their investors. Their top question they received, will the AI transition destroy your existing cloud companies? These are some very intelligent people. The same question's been raised by many of our paying subscribers who seem to be equally intelligent, if not more. Sequoia says here, we began with a strong default of no, so they don't believe that SaaS is threatened. And they talk about how there's a classic battle here. This is interesting, between startups and incumbents, where startups are trying to build distribution to get out to a broad array of customers, whilst incumbents already have that. So they're just building product, or maybe they do acquihires, or they acquire the technologies they need. But Sequoia was thinking that everyone has access to the power of AI. We're all in the same playing field. And they say, that being said, we're no longer so sure. So that's not good, right? But they say, what if we're just dramatically underestimating what it means to be AI native? And then they give this example of replacing Salesforce. And they say this day.ai, we've seen a glimpse of the future. It's an AI native CRM. And, you know, Salesforce makes billions of dollars configuring their tool for their clients. And with nothing more than access to your email and calendar and a quick questionnaire, this day automatically generates a CRM that's perfectly tailored to your business. It doesn't have all the bells and whistles, they say, but the magic of an auto-generated CRM remains fresh with zero human input. Well, in my previous life, I worked with a very large financial services firm, and I was responsible for helping the sales, the enterprise sales teams integrate their processes into a implementation of Salesforce. I did a lot of work on that. I'm very suspect of these claims. It's phenomenally complex. Sure, in small businesses that might work, but in large corporations, the configurability around Salesforce, you wouldn't believe how customized that solution is. So I'm sure that's possible someday, perhaps, but right now I think that maybe not the case. Now, Sequoia talks about the investment universe and where they might dabble. Remember, this is from the perspective of a venture capitalist. So they say an infrastructure, that's the domain of hyperscalers. It's a terrible place for VCs to be. As far as models, they say, this is an interesting comment, how hyperscalers are trading balance sheets, the cash in their balance sheets, for income statements. They're investing money. It's going to round trip back to their cloud businesses in the form of compute revenue. Interesting. Developer tools and infrastructure software, they see an opportunity there. 15 companies with a billion plus in revenue were created at this layer during the cloud transition, and they suspect the same could be true for AI. And they say apps is the most interesting layer for VCs. 20 application layer companies with $1 billion in revenue were created during the cloud transition, and mobile. Here you can see that diagram and where AI is leading us to perhaps a new generation of software companies. The winner takes all story doesn't seem to work here. We hear that parroted by some individuals. And you need to also consider incidental beneficiaries. For example, there's been a lot of talk around the demand for high power for AI data centers. This is taken from a CB Insights report on the future of generative AI. Utility plays seem quite compelling. As interest rates fall, as they are doing, then utilities typically rise. So this is an interesting play. We did a video on that. We also did a recent video on nuclear power. There's a lot of hype there. It's relatively early. You have to remember that scaling up new nuclear power takes a long time, at least one administration. So a lot of things can change. We love incidental plays. So if there's a great utility company and you invest in it to get some incidental exposure to the growth of AI, I mean, that's a really good idea, right? You win either way, even if the bull thesis doesn't prove to be true. If it's a good company, always invest in quality companies. Just remember when it comes to nuclear that there's also a lot going on in the startup world. Be very wary of any sort of SPAC that comes out that doesn't have any revenues with nothing but a team and a dream. And when it comes to LLMs, I wanted to discuss briefly this slide by CB Insights because it was so interesting. So researchers have been tricking LLMs to generate a step-by-step plan to destroy humanity. And you could zoom in and read some of these. rather funny in a dark way. But this is a problem. This is an unknown, what Rumsfeld refers to as that. This could potentially result in a moratorium. And there's a lot of things that could happen here in terms of the dangers of AI. I think Elon Musk has discussed that extensively. But just some concluding thoughts here. Mr. Musk also says the only thing that matters for a technology is the rate of change, and nothing has ever changed as fast as AI. Jensen says it's because we've reinvented computing. We've driven down cost 1,000 times versus 100 times with Moore's Law. Somebody correctly said on one of our recent videos, today AI is the worst it will ever be. When you think about NVIDIA as an investment theme, it's pretty easy to justify NVIDIA staying on this. This is the list of the top companies in the world, staying on this list or topping it over the next decade or so. But remember, this is based on relative valuations. The market caps you see here could change dramatically across the board in what's called market risk. And I wanted to point out a couple quick things here for retail investors. Investing in AI is very tricky because of all the hype, and this table here shows one example of a trick that companies will play where they say their AI revenues are growing, but at the top line, they're not. It's just a labeling exercise. Be very careful about people trying to convince you some stock is the next NVIDIA or some great AI stock. That's where we come in, subscribe to our channel, and we'll sift through all that hype for you. The ground truth for AI product market fit is always revenue growth. And just remember that company-specific risk, you know, these people suggesting you invest in one stock, or market risk, unknown unknowns, these will kick your ass over time. So be wary of that. A three-fund portfolio with all the benefits that AI stands to bring to mankind across all industries, a three-fund portfolio is going to do you just fine. So for those of you that do want to dabble more in investing in AI, I've put up this piece in investing in the companies that help build data centers. Give that a watch. Make sure to subscribe to our channel. Thanks so much for taking the time to watch this today.